Let's join together in the call to worship. I'll let these people get in. Let's join in the call to worship printed in the bulletin. The Lord's unfailing love and mercy never cease.
Fresh is the morning and sure as the sunrise.
God created the day and night, made summer and winter.
Let us enter God's kingdom and worship the creator of the earth. Let us worship God together.
Please be seated. In worship, we have the opportunity to set things right with God. We admit our sin and our wrongdoing and seek God's forgiveness and grace. Let us ask God to guide and strengthen us as we pray together the prayer of confession. Merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you, thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart and mind and strength. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us amend what we are and direct what we shall be, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. The glory of God surpasses human knowledge. It shines forth on all humanity. It announces the victory of love over hate and good over evil. Grace is ours today. Thanks be to God.
Into the world to condemn the world. God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. God so love the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoso believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Everlasting, everlasting life. God so loved the world.
Dick Wilson, a member of our summer choir. We're delighted to have Jim Smith directing our choir today. He's good whether he's directing our choir or the one he brings with him from Peace College. He also brought the Vice President of Finance from Peace College to play the organ for us today. Of course, Craig Barfield's always here. There's another contingent representing Peace College in a historic way today, sitting down front. This is the family of Dr. and Mrs. Henry J. Stockard. They were members of First Presbyterian Church from December 3rd, 1900, the year this sanctuary was built, to the time of their deaths. Dr. Stockard was president of Peace College from 1907 to 1912. You know the granddaughter, Mary Bates Sherwood, and Brother Frank Sherwood. Mary Bates' birthday's coming up this week, and so they thought this was a good time to have a family reunion and come to church. So we're delighted to have an esteemed group with us in church this morning. You don't have to be Presbyterian or connected with Peace College to come here. It helps, but if you are visiting, wherever you're from, just sign it on the Friendship Register as it comes down the row. And if you put a name and address there, our friendly visiting folks, whoever's on duty this week, will be glad to come see you. They really do this. They'll bring you a little welcoming gift from our church and answer any questions you have. I mean, they don't force their way inside the house or anything. They just say, hello, glad to have you. Here's your stuff. If you don't put an address and phone number, we'll get the idea you don't want us to check you out. But if you do, you'll find out this is indeed a warm, welcoming church and a great place to grow as a disciple. Some new disciples that are growing with us are the Peacock family. Now, you've seen them around here for about 7 years, but for various reasons, they weren't sure they were going to be here. But now that they decided they're going to stay, Jim and Kim Peacock and their son Davis are joining. Davis will be baptized officially next Sunday at 8:30, but the session welcomed them into the membership of the Presbyterian Church USA today. When I first came here almost 8 years ago now, one of the first things I heard about was the all-church retreat. They said, this is the most fun we have. It's allowed, if you're Presbyterian, to go up to Montreat and have fun for a weekend in March. And it's always the week before the ACC tournament. We have, you know, we know what's important here. So, but this year it's going to be the 20th anniversary of that. So maybe we ought to make it special. So Wayne and Peggy Campbell, who are organizing this thing, two of our most organized people, are meeting this afternoon at 5 o'clock for a brainstorming session. So if you'd like to join them, they'll be in Memorial Hall to look on the 20th anniversary of the All-Church Retreat. If you look in your bulletin, you'll also see this Friday, Mary Jo Littlewood invites you to Adult Scams, Fraud, and Physical Harm, a workshop with folks from the Raleigh Police Department and the State Division of Aging and Adult Services. There are people who prey on us old people, thinking they can get our money, and we'd rather have it go to the church. So come to this workshop Fridays, 10 to noon this Friday, and it'll be in Memorial Hall. Beth Fields is working on an upcoming event that we haven't had since, again, 8 years ago, right before I came to church. We had a blood mobile in conjunction with the Good Shepherd, but we're having our very own one in November, Sunday the 25th, if enough people sign up for it. The Red Cross needs about 30 guaranteed pints of blood for them to come. It's going to be on a Sunday, so if you get here before the 8:30 service, you can give blood at 7:30, and you have an excuse for eating cookies in church, I guess, and then they'll be here until 12:30. Now, Beth reminds me you have to be 17 years of age or older. That covers most of you. And at least 110 pounds. So based on those criteria, they can get 2 pints out of me. So I'm signed up for November 25th, but contact Beth Fields, and it's in First Press if you need the information. Well, we're delighted to have you worshiping with us today here at First Presbyterian Church.
I'd like to share some pastoral concerns. This past week, Marion Fuller, long-term member of the church, passed away on Wednesday of a brain hemorrhage. The visitation is tomorrow evening at Brown Wynn on Millbrook, and the service will be 10 o'clock Tuesday here at the church. And also this past week, Jim Sally's father, John Lee Sally, passed away in Swansboro. His service was held on the 9th of August at First Baptist Church in Swansboro. Sympathy is extended to Tom and Judith Miller on the death of Tom's father, who died Friday in Greenville, South Carolina. We've had several folks in and out of the hospital this past week. Mary Lou Presley is at Mayview, home from rec, still on antibiotics for an infection that they found. And at Mayview, she's in the room right next to Louise Cooper, if you're familiar with Mayview. Jean Crow continues to recover from intestinal surgery at Brunswick Community Hospital, and she may go home in the next couple of days. John says that she's not up for visitors or phone calls right now, but is certainly grateful for all the prayers and friends at First Presbyterian. Dr. Al Edwards had another procedure done on his eye on Thursday. He's recovering at home, as is Margaret from her recent hospitalization. And Martha Del Stock was discharged on Monday, and she's here today, so we're glad she's doing better. Good to see her. Let us look to God in a time of prayer. Great and glorious God, we pause for a moment of quiet in the midst of another busy day. We thank you for the beauty of your world, for blue skies and sunshine, for a soft breeze which relieves us from the heat, for the fading of a day into the silence of a night. We thank you for the sounds of nature, a welcome relief from the hum of the air conditioner, the buzz of a dryer, or the ringing of a cell phone. Help us to honor those special moments and to find that quiet place within us that nurtures them. We thank you for the peace of this sanctuary, for heads bowed in prayer and hearts open to your word and your love. May this day of rest surely bring us Sabbath peace and renewal. But great God, we know that beyond these walls there is war, violence, injustice, and greed. Heal your world, Lord, that we might find peace and do our part in bringing it to others. And within these walls, loving God, there are hurting people. We all have our special needs, worries, and concerns, some that we're willing to share and ask for prayers for, but there are others that hide within the depths of our souls or the hollows of our heart. We pray for healing for all those with special needs, the sick, the dying, the brokenhearted. We pray for those filled with anger and rage. We pray for those who lash out at others and those who suffer from their words and actions. Holy God, fill us with the power of your Holy Spirit that we might sense the needs of others, be moved to compassion and care. Help us to share our bounty with those who have little, and help us to welcome others in your name and to be willing to reach out in friendship to the friendless. Help us to be your body at work in the world, for we make this prayer in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This time, I'd like to welcome the children down in the front. If you'll join me on the steps, please. Well, good morning. It's good to see everyone. How many of y'all have been away sometime this summer, maybe to grandparents or to the beach or the mountains? Everybody? Just about everybody? Well, you know what I have to do when I go on a vacation or a trip? I always have to make a list of what I need. I'm going to make sure that I've got everything I need when I get there. One time I went to the all-church retreat, and I ended up with 10 shirts in my suitcase and not enough of everything else. But so I make a list now and make sure that I have everything. So if we were going on a camping trip,
What do you think we would need? Y'all help me come up with a list. Yes. A sleeping bag. That's true. What else?
A tent.
A tent or a camping trailer or a cottage, perhaps. Yes.
Maybe a teddy bear.
A teddy bear. I think that's a good idea. That makes us feel like we're still close to home and something familiar that makes us comfortable. Yes. A flashlight. You know, I didn't have one of those this week. Okay, what else?
Yes.
Or possibly a pocket knife. What else?
Backpack.
That's good. So you have your arms free when you're out. Backpack. What else?
Firewood.
Definitely, if you're going to build a fire or charcoal or something, right? What else?
Marshmallows.
Yeah, you know. I think they are really nice on a camping trip. I agree with you. Well, our scripture lesson today, which you're going to hear Bob Inskeep read in a few minutes, says that as Christians that we need to be dressed and ready for action. That means that we need to have the things with us that we need to do God's will and to carry out his purposes. And if I was getting ready to go to a trip like this, a camping trip, you know, I'd want to have my tennis shoes right there and all everything all together and be ready so that I could just get up and go whenever someone called to me and said, it's time to go. And in scripture, it says that we need to be dressed for action or dressed for service and be ready because we know that Jesus Christ will be coming again and we want to be ready for that. So we want our lives to be live to his glory, and we want to follow his call to us. So I got another little list over here, and this one says, when Jesus comes again, and I've got three things that we might want to have or be ready for. And the first one is that we know that he's our Lord and Savior. And the second one is that we know that he forgives sins, and we ask him to forgive our sins. And then the rest is just to be ready to follow him when he calls and where he calls us to go. So these are the things that we need so that we'll know and be prepared to go with Jesus. Let us pray. Thank you, dear God, for all the wonderful blessings that you give us, the opportunity to explore your beautiful world and to see different parts of it. But we thank you most of all for the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ. And we thank you that he will come again and take us with him in glory. In your name we pray, amen.
Let us pray for illumination. God, our helper, show us your holy ways and teach us your paths. By your Holy Spirit, open our minds that we may be led in your truth and taught your will. Then may we praise you by listening to your word and by obeying it. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our first lesson today is Isaiah chapter 1, verses 11 through 17. In it, God has lost patience with false religious practices and shares with his people the direction he wishes them to follow. Listen now to God's word. What to me is the multitude of your sacrifices, says the Lord? I have had enough of burnt offerings of rams and the fat of fed beasts. I do not delight in the blood of bulls or of lambs or of goats. When you come to appear before me, who asked this from your hand? Trample my courts no more, bringing offerings is futile. Incense is an abomination to me. New moon and Sabbath and calling of convocation, I cannot endure solemn assemblies with iniquity. Your new moons and your appointed festivals my soul hates. They have become a burden to me. I am weary of bearing them. When you stretch out your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Even though you make many prayers, I will not listen. Your hands are full of blood. Wash yourselves. Make yourselves clean. Remove the evil of your doings from before my eyes. Cease to do evil. Learn to do good. seek justice, rescue the oppressed, defend the orphan, plead for the widow. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you, Helen. Good teachers make good lay readers. In my sermon today, I'm going to tell you about a teacher who made a good preacher. The gospel lesson comes from Luke's chapter 12, Luke's gospel. Jesus said, "Don't be afraid, little flock, for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Sell your possessions and give alms. Make purses for yourselves that don't wear out, an unfailing treasure in heaven, where no thief comes near and no moth destroys. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Be dressed for action and have your lamps lit. Be like those who are waiting for their master to return from the wedding banquet so that they may open the door for him as soon as he comes and knocks. Blessed are those slaves whom the master finds alert when he comes. Truly I tell you, he will fasten his belt and have them sit down to eat, and he will come and serve them. If he comes during the middle of the night or near dawn and finds them so, blessed are those slaves. But know this, if the owner of the house had known at what hour the thief was coming, he would not have let his house be broken into. You also must be ready, for the Son of Man is coming at an unexpected hour." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. An elderly couple asks for an appointment to see the pastor. He figures they're coming to inquire about a niche in the columbarium. But the older gentleman says, "We'd like to see about a divorce." The pastor's shocked. "Divorce? You've been married over 50 years. Why a divorce? Now?" The woman speaks up. "We just figured enough is enough." How much is enough? A couple in their 70s recently downsized from a full-size house in 45 years of marriage. And that's tough to squeeze everything into two bedrooms, as you Glen Eyre folks know how that works. But you know what? Almost every day, the UPS truck drives up and drops off a package from QVC. Somebody in that overflowing two-bedroom apartment is watching TV and buying even more stuff. How much is enough? Now, some preachers preach on more and more. That's called the gospel of prosperity. Because God loves you, God wants you to have more stuff. Remember the prayer of Jabez. Jabez called on the God of Israel saying, "Oh, that you would bless me and enlarge my border." I checked and decided my borders were enlarged enough. But our Lord's Prayer, which we just said, asks God for our bread for today. Not a year's worth, not the whole bakery, just what we need for today. We trust in God to provide what we truly need. Once you have enough, what then? Well, once you have enough stuff, you can acquire some of the other great gifts. The gift of trust in God, that God will provide. God will guide you. God will help you see you already have what you need. You have gracious plenty to do your share of the work in God's kingdom. But those of us who already have lots of stuff get real antsy when we hear Jesus say, "Sell your possessions and give alms." Elsewhere he says, "Sell all you have and give it to the poor." Is that so? A prosperous Presbyterian Sunday school class in a church not far from here was asked about that. The question was, would Jesus say that today? Sell all your possessions? Amazingly, every single member of that class said, "No, Jesus wouldn't say that, not to us." I was kind of amazed to hear that. First of all, I didn't know that we got to vote whether Scripture, you know, certain parts applied and certain didn't. I kind of thought it was, you know, God's eternal word. Those Sunday school members, though, who look an awful lot like you and me, then began a most intelligent flurry of rationalizing their answers. One man said, "Jesus wouldn't want me to give away all my possessions. Remember the parable of the talents? The one who did the most with what he had was given more. Well, I'm a banker. I know how to invest that money. If I were to give it all to the poor, they would just squander it all away." Well, that makes sense. I wish I'd been there. I'd like to ask him Dr. Phil's question. "Well, how's that working for you? How many hundreds of thousands of dollars have you made through investing that you've been able to help the poor?" Of course, I can't point a finger at him, of course, because neither I nor any of you could convince ourselves to just up and give everything away. But that's not the real message of this portion of Luke's gospel. You get to keep your teddy bear. The gospel writer, Luke, is an educated and we might assume somewhat prosperous person, traditionally thought to be a physician. The Christians in his community had their own houses and goods. As Luke relates this teaching, Jesus is simply contrasting the world values of greed and grasping with God's values. Tom Wright says, "When Jesus speaks of treasure in heaven, here and elsewhere in the Gospels, this doesn't mean treasure that you will only possess after death. Essentially, he says, we live in God's heavenly kingdom when we live by God's values and priorities, not the values and anxieties of the world. Look up from your pile of stuff and you might see the poor people who could use your help. You might very well see the face of God." I think the practice of faithful Christians has become tithing. If you invest the first 10% of your income in God's kingdom, you're a full stakeholder. You're fully invested, especially when you're also giving 10% of your time and talent. Just 10%. You don't have to give the 100%. Although one woman I know talked about symbolically divesting herself of all that she had, Nancy Stokes is a commissioned lay pastor who will be speaking at our Wednesday noon service a week from this Wednesday. And she talked about going with a group from her church, Kirk of Kildare, on the Appalachian Service Project. And she said, "When you're sleeping on the floor of a gym in your sweatsuit and there's not a Walmart within 50 miles, you might as well not have anything." And so, stripped of all her worldly stuff and her worldly concerns, she was able to have her eyes open to see a great treasure in an Appalachian woman who, from appearances, looked very poor on the surface, but whose faith was richer than any that Nancy had ever seen. In this 12th chapter of Luke, there's a sense of urgency. Time is short. You don't know when the master is coming. Does Jesus mean get ready for judgment day? Are we to prepare for the parousia, the second coming? Again, Tom Wright, in his little book, Luke for Everyone, Tom Wright writes that Jesus may be referring to the nation as a whole, those listening to him. He may be issuing a warning about what's going to happen to the temple. Wright says that this and a subsequent parable in Luke chapter 19 refer to the return of God to Zion. And Jesus tells those listening to him, it's happening already. God has returned in the person of Jesus, and the people weren't ready. The great upheaval is about to happen in the crucifixion. And after the crucifixion, as far as that temple is concerned, just wait 40 years and the Romans will come in and run roughshod over that and the temple will be destroyed. Don't wait. Be prepared today. Being prepared for the master's return The bridesmaids prepared by getting oil for their lamps. The slaves were working and alert when the master returned. Slaves weren't rich. They were using their talents. Ah, aren't we all rich in talents? So how are you investing your talents in God's kingdom? Jan Maynard belongs to this little church up in Warrenton. They have 21 members. That's a pretty small church. I remember when I went to serve that church out in Johnston County, Fairview, they had 12 members. And I was talking to a minister friend of mine, and I said, I was going there, and he said, well, what happened to the previous pastor? And I said, well, he died. And my minister friend asked, of what? Starvation? Pretty small church. Well, the Warrenton Church was blessed to get the services of Dr. Orville Wintermute, a retired professor at Duke, but he told them up front he was only there for a limited time. And besides, his idea of being pastor is to be a talent scout. He encouraged the various church members to take responsibility for their church and their worship service. He said, the church is the people. Use the gifts that are already here. And in Jan Maynard, he saw someone who seemed to have a lot of gifts. And he asked her to consider becoming a commissioned lay pastor and go to the 2 years of intensive training through our presbytery. Jan's first response, not me. But then she said she thought about it and prayed about it and thought, well, maybe I could do that. Probably should do that. So she did it. I got to hear Jan preach this past January. When she finished, a retired minister who was there helping me evaluate the commission lay pastors on their preaching, that retired minister told Jan that was as fine a sermon as he had ever heard on the Eucharist in his 30-plus years in ministry. Well, no wonder. Jan is a fascinating woman. She taught school in Alaska for 30 years. She lives on a farm now in Warrenton, raising cows and horses and chickens and dogs. What a wealth of experience she brings to each sermon she preaches. And her teacher's mind helps her organize her thoughts such that we can understand it. I hope she'll get to preach at our presbytery when we meet sometime, just so they can hear how good a commissioned lay pastor can be. Now, some of you know Jan because she took disciple here at our church with Betty Jordan as part of her biblical training. So you know she's a bright, fascinating person who's still learning. Remember Jan said she thought, I could do it, I should do it. Now she thinks, this has been a blessing to me. She said, I've grown in ways I've never dreamed of. So not only has her little church benefited from her great gifts, as well as some of the other churches that she preaches at, but Jan herself has grown in faith and grown closer to God. She already knows now from experience what it's like to walk with one foot in heaven already, walking humbly with her Lord. Well, as we always say in stewardship season, be good stewards or managers of your gifts, your talent, and your time. Time. That may be what's most precious to you. I always love the response that was given to the person who said, oh, I don't have enough time. And the response was, you have all there is. This morning you woke up and God gave you another 1,000 minutes of time. That's allowing 8 hours for sleep, basically 1,000 minutes each day. What we got. Now, here in America, a lot of people seem now to have more money than time. And so they spend some of their extra money on time-saving things, such as coaches, perhaps a fashion coach, someone who will shop for you because you don't have enough time, and she helps you dress for success so you can make even more money and have even less time. A recent Newsweek article said that aging boomers, the aging baby boomers, have come to the realization there's not that much more left to buy. So they're turning their attention to more important things. Planetary issues, environmental concerns, the whole idea of eating healthy, consuming locally grown produce, which reduces the carbon impact of the food you eat from, you know, the cost of fuel and exhaust of shipping it across the country to you. Better to eat locally. And on a good note, this Newsweek article said many of these boomers are investing some of their wealth and time in worthwhile missions here and around the world, looking for a little meaning instead of more money. They have enough. So maybe you're blessed with lots of talents and you have enough money. What about time? Is time your most precious resource? What do you do when God requires some of your time? Do you ever resent demands on your time? A friend of mine shared with me her story about that, just in time. She has a demanding job in the city, but in her heart, she's a country girl, about a 50-year-old country girl. Last Saturday morning, she was in her garden picking purple hull peas. Of course, picking the peas is just the beginning of the project. And then she remembered that it was her church's turn to staff the local youth shelter that night, and she found herself grumbling about having too much to do that day, to spend the whole evening supervising kids. Sometimes even very good Christians are reluctant to part with their precious time, even in service to their church and its mission. But then it occurred to her that since she was assigned to supervise the basketball gym that evening, she'd be sitting there for several hours, and she could easily shell her peas then. So that's what she did. She took her peas to the gym, and she was amazed at what happened. Let me read from her email. You know, God used those peas to draw some young kids my way. It was an unusual sight for them to see someone sitting shelling peas. A fourth grader who was there with his older brother inched closer and closer to me until he finally asked me what I was doing, and then if he could help. His questions about the peas were unusual for a kid his age, and I realized that he actually cooks at his house, fourth grader. He wanted to know if you boiled them, if the peas needed to be washed before cooking them, how long to cook the peas, etc. My bowl filled up, and he asked if he could have the rest of the peas. I put the extra peas in a bag for him. He was clutching that bag when he left the gym like he really had something special. A bag of peas, some time. You are rich in resources to get to work alongside God, to be a light in the world who most need a ray of hope, a word of encouragement. You have something special to give. And you probably don't need a whole lot more stuff. Jesus said, beware of greed. In Luke 12:15, Jesus says, eternal hope doesn't lie in a pile of stuff. Jesus says, possessions don't equal life. Jesus seems to be saying we might find it liberating to free ourselves from obsessing too much about our stuff. Simply take stock of how rich you already are. See what you could be doing for the needy, and thus for God. And like the pea lady or the lay pastor Jan, you might find that you are indeed richly blessed yourself, walking with one foot already in heaven. Remember later in Luke, Jesus says, to whom much has been entrusted, even more will be demanded. That's a little different. Not to whom much is given, to whom much is entrusted. In other words, all your stuff, especially those perishable purple hull peas, are simply on loan from God. And you don't even know how much time you have to get to work with them. In the prayer of St. Francis, he asks God to let him be an instrument on behalf of God.
You have the tools, the gifts, the time, the talent, to be an instrument of God's grace in your little corner of the world, which looks an awful lot like heaven when you lift your eyes from your stuff to see God's people. How much is enough? You have enough. You have gracious plenty.
Please remain standing for our affirmation of faith. It's drawn from a writing of the late Shirley Guthrie years ago on behalf of the Presbyterian Church to put into meaningful language for us some of what we Presbyterians believe about God and Jesus. This is drawn from a declaration of faith. Let us affirm what we believe. God makes himself known in Jesus Christ. Jesus' involvement in the human condition is God's involvement. His compassion for all kinds of people is God's compassion. His demand for justice, truth, and faithfulness is God's demand. His willingness to suffer rejection is God's willingness. Jesus' love for the very people who reject him is God's love. Please be seated. During our morning offering, you might go back and reread the words of that hymn we just sang, God whose giving knows no ending. As we present to God our tithes and offerings, and this morning our pennies for hunger, let us, as we sang, open wide our hands in sharing, as we heed Christ's ageless call, healing, teaching,
and reclaiming, serving God by loving all. For our offertory prayer, I'm going to use the words from that hymn again. God, whose giving knows no ending, from your rich and endless store, gifted by you, we turn to you.
offering up ourselves in praise. Thankful song shall rise forever. Gracious donor of our days. Amen. As you leave from here today, may you walk with the Master, using all the many gifts and talents and the time that you've been given, empowered to use them by our most precious gift, the gift of faith. May God continue to bless you and keep you, smiling upon you, being gracious to you, and giving you peace. Amen.